Hi, I'm Wes, the Explosion, and this is my top 10 games that I played in 2021. Something to note before we begin, I chose these 10 from the list of games that I discussed in my series The Backlog. Most of them weren't released this year, and heck, a few were games that I didn't even play for the first time. When I made a list of every game that I featured on The Backlog, I then made two more. One for the ones I enjoyed enough to consider putting on this video, and another for ones that I really hated playing, and I'm pleased to say that the good list had 23 titles and the bad had only 14. And I was much choosier about what made the former. It seems that I had more fun than pain this year. This did make it extremely hard to pick the top 10 though, and I feel like if I had to decide on the list again tomorrow, it could be quite different depending on what I decided to place importance on, but hey, for today and this video, this is what I'm ranking as my favorite things that I played this past year. Number 10 is Warriors All-Stars. Sure, I was unfamiliar with many of the characters, and I played even fewer of the games that they're from, but hey, I picked up one of them that I knew from their mediocre anime adaptation, and I was off to the races. This isn't my favorite Musou game, but I love the series and spin-off enough that it was fun enough to make the cut. I just love the hack-and-slack action, taking on hundreds, sometimes thousands at once, figuring out the best combos to use, how to cheese some of the beefier enemies, and just generally feeling like a badass as I rip through enemy forces. In addition to that, there's also some sexy furry people, namely the MILF and Broody Boy, more so than the goofy-looking male Crystal and Lolly. Where to begin with number 9? First off, it's The Legend of Zelda, Wind Waker HD. The art style is beautiful and has somehow been improved in this latest version. Link has more expressions than normal, the world has many delightful denizens, it's easy to spend hours just messing around with subquests, and most of the bosses are fun and memorable as well. This is a game that I'm down for starting up at any point when I need a break and just want something truly enjoyable to play. It's not even my favorite Zelda game, and yet it's one of my favorite overall. The only reason it's not higher on this list is because I played the original so much on the GameCube that some of the other games I played this year beat it out due to feeling fresher, at least for me. 8 is Celeste. You play as Madeline, you have some emotional issues, most notably depression, and you overcome them by both metaphorically and literally climbing a mountain. It's super challenging but fair, and there's a lot of extra stuff to do, so you can kind of decide on the game length for yourself. I love platformers, I love retro-style titles, and I love a good challenge in that sort of overlap, so this game is perfect for me. I also like the story and its message, including the hidden one, and how the game encourages you, even as you struggle. Overall, it's just a fantastic game. I played through number 7, Cuphead, I believe 3 times now. It's similar to Celeste, being a platformer with a retro, though in a cartoony as opposed to game sense, that's super challenging but fair. I think I like it slightly more than Celeste though, and this latest playthrough had its own traits that made it special. Namely that I feel like I killed it, only struggling on 2 bosses and maybe 1 run and gun. It gives me a feeling of great accomplishment, looking back at how hard the game was for me on my first time through, and I feel like if I continue to do runs here and there, I might eventually reach the point where I can get through it with little to no hiccups, which is a cool feeling to have. Number 6 is The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening Remake. I only ever really liked the 3D Zeldas, and only picked this one up on a whim, questioning why I did, as I figured I'd hate it for sure. Surprisingly, I loved my time with it, and was charmed not just by the toy-like art style, but the island of Koholint as well, especially Marin, who I figured would be more one-note and forgettable. I also got oddly obsessed with the crane minigame and cleared out all the special prizes. Unfortunately, I was familiar with the story beforehand and with the plot twist as well, so my first run wasn't as special as it could have been, but it's still the sort of thing that will stay with me. We're halfway through, so here's where I toss in some random favorites. My favorite book that I read this year was Kakpa by the Shore by Haruki Murakami. At this point, he's probably my second favorite author, only after Poe, and this is the first one I read by him, so I have some instant nostalgia for it. Conversely, the one that I hated the most that I at least finished this year was Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand. It's dumb, pretentious, and over 1,000 pages long, so it took me several years to get through, just because of how much I hated it. She was probably a terrible person. That's all I'm gonna say about books, since this is more of a video game channel, but I have discussed both of them in previous episodes of The Backlog if you want to know any specifics on them. But onward. Next is 5, Danganronpa 2, Goodbye Despair. I was familiar with the plot of the first game, so I started here. While I do have some complaints with some of the minigames you need to do during the trials, along with the crappy way they're explained, as well as some of the bizarre ways you need to combine a few of the clues together, I can't deny how invested I became in the characters and the plot in this murder mystery, and I played this in far fewer sit-downs than I should have. I am fully on board at this point and have one light novel, a spin-off game, and two anime queued up as I prepare to delve deeper into the franchise. Even if my favorites always die pretty early. And then super quick, my favorite thing that I watched through this year was Infinity Force. I love crossovers, Kashan, and just Tatsunoko in general, even if I sometimes find some of their stories dumb, so I had a lot of fun with this series and the movie sequel. Or at least that was my favorite this year until a few days ago when I watched Spider-Man No Way Home. I'm not gonna say too much about that since part of my joy from it came from me specifically avoiding spoilers, so I was able to go in and be quite surprised and engaged with the entire plot. But if you're a Marvel fan, especially if you're a Spider-Man fan, it's definitely worth a look. Next is 4, Super Mario 3D World plus Bowser's Fury. I played through 3D World twice before, but for some reason I just got super into it this time around. Before, I'd always considered Mario games just kind of the standard, almost generic version of platformers, laying the groundwork as everyone else innovated for more unique experiences, and Super Mario Galaxy was one of the few that managed to grab me. After running through 3D World this time, though, I came to the conclusion that I really do like Mario. Then, moving on to Bowser's Fury, this idea was only strengthened. I normally like more linear, level-oriented games, but the scattered sandboxes in this were tons of fun to play around in. Add in the Fury Bowser appearances, throwing a wrench into things and switching things up, and it was another joy to play. I really wasn't sure if I wanted to buy a port of 3D World when I still owned the Wii U version, but the addition to Bowser's Fury made it worth it for me. I'm very curious to see if Nintendo uses any of these ideas going forward. And hey, I think I might even like Bowser Jr. now, which is an accomplishment in and of itself. And now for some more odds and ends, namely the weirdest game I played, Senran Kagura Reflections. In a year where I played a bullet hell arcade shooter that was a literal hentai porn game where the goal of one of the first levels was to make it with a Jiangshi, this was kind of an accomplishment. I like the Senran Kagura series for all of the obvious reasons, in addition to enjoying the hack and slash gameplay, the rockin' soundtrack, and the actually better than you'd expect story, but this was an unusually strange entry, even for it, with the goal of getting out of some weird dreamscape by massaging 5 of the most popular characters in lucid fantasies until they fell in love with you enough to remember who they were and break you both out of the entrapping barrier, in a tale that I don't think is canon, but I'm not 100% sure. I believe the game was conceived around the whole idea that the team wanted to use the Joy-Con's HD rumble to simulate the feeling of boobs, which is silly and dumb, yet very appropriate for a series that was created from the notion that what people want to see most in 3D is bouncing breasts. It's not really a good game, I don't even think I'd call it fun given how repetitive it is, but there's something amusing about its novelty. Deltarune Takes 3. I suppose it's specifically Chapter 2 that I'm putting here, but hey, both are parts of an eventual whole, so Deltarune. I never thought that we'd go beyond one, and yet here we are, and it was worth the wait? Can I call it a wait if I thought it would never come? Anyway, I also played Undertale this year, but while I had fun, that game was kinda ruined for me when the internet spoiled the whole thing to hell and back, so part of what makes Deltarune so special is that I was able to play it on my own terms. And it's delightful! I like sparing and recruiting all the different monsters in this game and adding them to my own little hub world. I love all the writing and different characters on display here. Even the ones I hated I loved by the end. I love trying to figure out what's going on and what will happen next. I love the music. I love the nods to other games that are here. And I just really love Deltarune, so much so that, while not terribly long, I kinda lost track of time with Chapter 2 and hammered it all out in one session, eagerly awaiting more upon completion. Given that's what's out so far is free, it's probably the easiest to recommend on this list, and a part of me even feels bad that I got it for nothing. Please, Toby, next time let me pay you. I chose the passive route, so you know that I have a conscience. As for the games I hated playing, I was originally going to do its own video for my top 5, but I didn't want to go back and get more footage for the montage, and some of the games that would have made it on the list weren't actually bad games, they just weren't personally to my taste, and I didn't really want a ton of dislikes, so we're just gonna go with a few quick mentions here. I like Metroid Prime, but Hunters for the 3DS had crappy controls that hurt my hands, constantly respawning enemies, the same two bosses repeated over and over again, and really awkward platforming. I like horses, but hate riding them in video games, and riding towards a vaguely hinted at direction was a big part of Shadow of the Colossus. Combine that with the actual combat itself not clicking with my ADHD and feeling more like a slog than a fun puzzle. I'm sure it's a fun game, it's just not fun for me. I hated every Sonic game I played this year. I seem to have saved all of the notorious ones for 2021 for some dumb reason and didn't even complete half of them that I picked up. Honestly, the one that I thought was the best was the notoriously glitchy Sonic Boom, which I found downright okay. And I think the one I hated the most was Legends of Troy. I like Warriors games, as evidenced from the earlier post in the list, but this one just sucked. Everything had ugly, dull colors, the combat wasn't fluid, and the upgrades that replaced leveling here were boring and tedious to equip and swap from each character. They took something fun and made it suck, simple as that. Number 2 is Metroid Dread. It was my favorite game to come out this year, bar none, which might hint a bit too heavily at what number 1 is, but we're not there yet. First, it was just so cool how it was announced without warning, and then bam, months later, it was in our hands. And it was good, so good. It was fun to play, it was fun to wander around and explore, it was fun to see what old and new power-ups I could get. The bosses were bizarre but cool and had a really solid learning curve. I would sometimes go into a boss and get ripped to shreds in seconds, only to later learn the patterns enough where I could just clear a whole phase while only getting hit maybe once. The enemy were horror done right, being threatening and aggressive enough to keep me panicking, and the consequences for failing were significant enough that I didn't get complacent, but not harsh enough to make me give up. I also really enjoyed the story, enough to make its own video dedicated to it, and while it did take a backseat to gameplay, there was enough mystery there to keep me curious and enough twists to keep me on my toes. I know some complained about the relatively short length of the game, but given how replayable this title is, I find it almost unfair to mark that against it and feel like it's the sort of thing that I can play over and over again. And now for the honorable mentions that I put on the full list but didn't crack the top 10. I still wanted to acknowledge that I did have fun with them though, so here they are in no particular order. Splatoon 2, Donkey Kong Country 2, No Straight Roads, River City Girls, Capcom Beat'em Up Collection, Undertale, Panzer Paladin, Shantae and the Seven Sirens, New Pokemon Snap, WarioWare Get It Together, Dead Cells, Lost in Random, Shovel Knight Shovel of Hope, and Guacamelee 2. All good games which I would recommend. And my favorite game that I played this year was, of course, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. In case you're new to the channel, I did pretty hefty reviews for Metroid Dread, which I loved, the Warrior series as a whole, the Pokemon Gen 4 remakes, which I both loved and hated, and was pretty thorough with talking about games like New Pokemon Snap and Shantae, but the one game that I think I featured the most throughout all my videos this year was Smash Ultimate. A new character got released? Gonna talk about it. I spent a bunch of time practicing for an upcoming get-together? Might as well mention who I'm testing out. I read a book that tangentially has to do with Smash? Might as well play some video of the game in the background. Game Awards came up. Let's include a dig about how I only ever watched it for the Smash reveal. I have a friend that plays Kingdom Hearts? Why not record our first impressions of Sora? I want to do more Smash videos, and I have some in the works, but for now, let me just say that this is my favorite and most played game on the Switch, and yeah, I was probably at my peak when I played Melee back in the day, which might even play better, but it's my favorite in the series. It's just such a passion project, and barring a port, I don't think we'll ever get a crossover like this again, so for the billionth time, I'd just like to say, thank you, Nintendo. Thank you, Sora Unlimited, and thank you, Mr. Sakurai. Especially for that last Mega Man patch, though you could have left Min Min alone. That's my list. I know a lot have said that this was a slow year for gaming, but I really enjoyed what I picked up this year, and even more so did with what I already had lying around. I actually had to edit a few of my earlier paragraphs in the script because I just kept saying about how I either wanted to play more of a game or start up a whole new playthrough, which is a really good sign at just what a blast I had with them. Next year, I'm somewhat hesitantly looking forward to Legends Arceus, I'm very curious about Kirby and the Forgotten Land, and I'm quite excited for Splatoon 3. What can I say? I have a Nintendo bias. And I'm sure that's not the only things that'll come out, so I'm looking forward to 2022, at least when it comes to gaming. This Sunday, I plan on doing a review of 2021, at least when it comes to what I accomplished. But for now, thanks for watching. Maybe subscribe if you enjoy this sort of thing, and perhaps I'll see you then.